Let me ask you a question today. Does anyone here have any experience with sin? If you've got experience with sin, raise your hand. All right, everybody but the liars, raise their hand. Thank you for that. I'm just teasing you. The reality is we all do have plenty of experience with the subject and the presence of sin in our lives. And the question is not, do I have any sin in my life? The question is really, what am I going to do about it? I don't know if any of you have been able to see any of the Winter Olympics that have just started, but you know, they'll be on for a couple more weeks. I haven't seen any yet. I've been trying to keep up with it a little bit, but I haven't seen any. But I like the Winter Olympics. I love the speed skating, the skiing, and all of those things. And I'm really looking forward to seeing how America does. But the reality is, you have 3,000 athletes, 3,000, that's how many people are in Sochi right now, 3,000 of the world's best athletes in their events. They have battled their way up from the local level, sometimes most of the time from childhood, all the way up. They train, you know, at this level year round, and now this is it, the Olympics. But here's the thing. 3,000 athletes, do you know there are only 98 total medals are going to be given? Only 98 medals. That means that 2,900 plus of the world's best athletes are going to leave Russia with nothing but pictures on their iPhone of the Olympics to remember it, because there are only 98 total medals to be given out and 3,000 people competing. And you know, when you think about it, the difference between success and failure at that level is so slight. It's not mammoth. It's not like I put on a pair of skates and race the best skater and see what the difference would be. We're talking about all of them are world class. As a matter of fact, the last Olympics was held in Vancouver in 2010, and they have analyzed the differences between gold, silver, and bronze, and those who did not carry home on a medal at all, and the difference is unbelievable. In the Vancouver Olympics in 2010, the difference between gold and silver in an event that was timed, now obviously figure skating would not count because it's not a race, but in the events that were raced, that is, there were times, the difference between gold and silver, are you ready for this? On average, was 7/10 of a second. The difference between silver and bronze was even less, half a second, a split second. Can you imagine? You spend your whole life competing. You work your way up to the point that you are one of the best in the world. You head to the Olympics and you come around a turn just a little bit, a half a second slow, and you go from gold to silver. Or you come and you get someone passes you the baton in one of the relays, skating relays, and it comes to you a little slow and you don't even get a medal, and yet the difference in the time between the person who comes in fourth and the person who comes in first may be 1 second difference. You know, how many of you realize in life, it is often the small things in life that make a big, big difference? And you know the same thing is true in your spiritual life? Sometimes it's not the multitude of things, but it's the one thing that makes all the difference. Over the last several weeks, we've been talking about growing spiritually, the successful strategies of spiritual growth. We've mentioned five things you can do. One, build up a good, strong faith. Number two, be a person very involved in the life of your local church. Number three, get immersed in the study of Scripture. Number four, become a person of prayer. Number five, be willing to personally share your faith. All these things are things you can do. But no matter how many things you can do to grow in your spiritual life, I want you to know there's one thing you cannot do and you must not do. You must not continue to sin. You see, brothers and sisters, no matter how much you read your Bible, no matter how much you pray, no matter how much you go to church, no matter how much you share your faith with others, if you have unconfessed sin in your life, it will eventually destroy and deteriorate your Christian life. Everything sin touches, it torches. Everywhere it rules, it ruins. My brothers and sisters, sin fascinates, then it assassinates, it thrills, and then it kills. And I want you to understand today that if you want to grow in Christ, the sixth strategy of growing in Christ is not something you do, it's something you don't do. You say, well, how am I going to have the power to overcome this daily struggle that I have with sin? There's only one way, and that is the power of God's Holy Spirit working in you. And so this morning, I want us to look at the subject, strong in the Spirit. Would you open your Bibles with me, please, to the book of Galatians. Galatians. And how many of you have some German ancestry? Let me see your hand. All right, bunch of folks. How many of you have some Irish? Let me see your hand. All right, a bunch of folks. Most people in America have some German or Irish. That's pretty much established. And sometimes it's referred to as the Gaelic, you know, ethnicity, and the Celts, and the language of the Irish, ancient Celtic language was Gaelic. They came from the Gauls. And the Germans have some of the Gauls. And these Galatians actually descended from the same tribes that the Irish and the Germans descended from. So maybe some of you are Galatians. So let's turn to the book of the Irish today, chapter 5, okay? Galatians chapter 5. You say, Pastor, I don't know where I could use that little tidbit you just shared. I don't know either, but if you ever need it, you got it now. Amen? All right, Galatians chapter 5, verse 16. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Heavenly Father, help us today as we look at this strategic area that is so relevant to every one of us. God, give us your Spirit in increasing measure, Lord, without measure. We pray that you would help us and lead us and fill us by the Holy Spirit of God. In Jesus' name, all God's people said, amen. What are we dealing with today when we deal with the problem of sin, and how are we going to deal with it? Jerry Bridges, who wrote the book, The Pursuit of Holiness, once said, and I quote, "He is called the Holy Spirit, and he is sent primarily to make us holy, to conform us to the character of God." You know, when we think about the Holy Spirit, we often think about the fruit of the Spirit and the gifts of the Spirit and worship in the Spirit, and all of those things are so true. But remember what Jerry Bridges said, he is called the Holy Spirit. And one of the primary reasons that the Lord has sent us the Holy Spirit is to make his people holy in his presence. So this morning I want us to notice just one simple principle about the Holy Spirit's work in us to make us his people as we grow spiritually, to keep from undermining our own spiritual walk. I want us to look at this principle: walk in the Spirit to overcome sinful desire. Walk in the Spirit to overcome sinful desire. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, look at those verses again with that in mind. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. So what's the secret of overcoming the temptations and the desires that are part of us every day? That is, the Bible says, walk in the Spirit. This is not something I thought up. This isn't a 20th century or a 21st century phenomenon. It's not something that some denominations can do and others have a pass on. No, the Bible says, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, if you want to have victory in your Christian life, if you want to overcome the struggle that you have against the flesh and the desires of the flesh, you've got to do what? Walk in the Spirit. Jib Simbla, the pastor of Brooklyn Tab, said, and I quote, "I want to declare unequivocally that God still breaks chains today. No matter how strong the shackles of lust, drugs, alcohol, or deceit, the Spirit's power can break these fetters and set men and women free." How many of you would say a big amen to that truth? That God's Spirit can still set men and women free. Now, this book was written to a group of churches, not just to one church. You say, how do you know that? How do I know? Because the Bible tells me so. Look at the first chapter, the first verses. He said, Paul, to the churches at Galatia. He's writing to a group of churches in the mountainous region of the north central part of modern day Turkey. And he had founded those churches himself when he was in his second mission trip up in that area. But as soon as Paul founded the churches and then left, a heresy entered the church. And the heresy, which he deals with for six chapters of the book of Galatians, the heresy was, you cannot live by grace alone. You cannot live by faith alone. You've got to add the works of the law. You've got to go back to the Judaism, and Gentiles have to become Jews, and they have to incorporate works of the law, and grace is not enough. You've got to help God out. If you're going to go to heaven, you got to work your way to heaven. That was an ancient heresy, but how many of you know that is still a problem we have to deal with today? We still have a problem believing that God's grace alone is enough and I cannot get my way to heaven. I like what Adrian Rogers once said, I wouldn't trust my best 15 minutes to get me to heaven. It is by grace alone, through faith alone, that we are saved, and not of ourselves, lest any man should boast. But these churches had been caught up in a heresy of works and effort and trying to do it on their own. And so Paul writes and says, no, you've got to do it by the power of the Spirit. And the idea that somehow you're going to work your way to heaven or earn your way to heaven or impress God is a totally false idea, and it runs counter to the revelation of God. But here's the reality that every one of us is aware of, and that is that there are two powers working inside our lives. Two powers working inside our lives. The Bible calls one the Holy Spirit, and the other, the Bible calls the flesh. Now, what is the difference? What is the flesh? Well, the flesh is the principle in operation of the unsatisfied desires of the human life. The unsatisfied desires of the human life. And that's why some translations refer to the flesh as the sinful nature. And that's a good description. It's the ultimate self-life. It's that unsatisfied appetite that just can't seem to quite get enough. John R.W. Stott once said that flesh is who we are by natural birth, and spiritual is who we are by the new birth. The flesh, see if anybody can relate to this. The flesh's attitude is this: I want what I want, I want it now, I want more of it, and when I get it, I want something else. Can anybody relate? The flesh says, I want what I want it now, I want more of it, and when I get it, I want something else. But the Spirit inside of us leads us to say, instead of what's in it for me, the Spirit inside of us leads to say, how can I please God? And those two realities are at war within us all the time. And the Bible says the only way for you to come out as a gold medal winner in these Olympics is to have the Spirit of God leading you and assisting you. That's why the Bible says, I say, walk, listen, by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the sinful nature. So here's the question. How does the Holy Spirit help me stay strong in this daily battle against the desires of my flesh? You may say, Pastor, you have no idea what I'm dealing with. You have no idea how difficult this temptation is. You have no idea how overwhelming it is for me to have to deal with this. Yes, I do. In fact, everybody in here understands exactly what you're dealing with, maybe not in the same area, but every man and woman in this room is dealing with this battle. This is not just some of us. This is all of us. And if you think that somehow or another you are going to overcome the temptations in your life through willpower, you're fooling yourself, but nobody else. You do not have the willpower to overcome the temptations and the strongholds in your life. You say, but if I want to be right, doesn't that help? Well, of course, the incentive has to be there. But let me ask you a question. Don't you think Philip Seymour Hoffman wanted to live a clean life? He'd been dealing with this. You say, but Pastor, he had an addiction. Well, I understand he had an addiction, but here's my question. Where did the addiction come from? The addiction came from the same place that all of our temptations come from, unsatisfied human desire. And I follow 60 Minutes on Twitter, and yesterday 60 Minutes had a clip. They interviewed Philip Seymour Hoffman. You know, he's this actor who died of a heroin overdose. Maybe you didn't hear about it, but recently died of a heroin overdose. And I've never seen a movie he was in. I don't go to that many movies to start with, but some people I know say he was their favorite actor and one of the best actors to come along in a long time, had an Academy Award and all of that. And he was interviewed by 60 Minutes in 2006, and they said, well, you know, you went to rehab as a young man, and he said, that's right. And they said, was it for alcohol or drugs? He said, all of it. And he said, why? Why did you go to rehab? He said, because I was panicked. I was panicking. I couldn't control it. You see, ladies and gentlemen, he didn't want to die of a heroin overdose. And don't tell me, well, if we would just have more education, we'd have less sin. Philip Seymour Hoffman was an educated person. You say, if we just spread the wealth around, we'd have less sin. If we didn't have so much poverty. He had money. You say, well, if people had good jobs, there'd be less sin. He was at the top of the food chain in his industry. He was successful. He was famous. He was wealthy. He had 3 children. He had family. He had a support group. But he also had a monkey on his back. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Because, ladies and gentlemen, he had an addiction. But where does an addiction come from? It comes from an unsatisfied rebellion inside of us that says, I want what I want. I want more. I want it now. And when I get what I want something else. And brothers and sisters, nobody can overcome the power of the devil by him or herself. We must have the power of God's Holy Spirit in operation, helping us, leading us, and assisting us. You say, well, how does it work? Well, let me show you 4 principles real quick. You ready? Write this down. First of all, there's a command to walk in the Spirit. Look at verse 16. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Now, there's a pretty clear contrast. Walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. Notice the word walk. It's the Greek word peripateo. Peri means around, like periscope, paradigm. The word peri means around. And pateo means to walk around. That doesn't mean you're walking in circles, but it does mean the habits of your life. We would say, let the Spirit-controlled life be your lifestyle. As a matter of fact, we used to have an old expression. We don't use it much anymore, but some of you remember the expression, the walk of life. In other words, we'd say, you know, in our church, people come from different walks of life. He says, some are college students and some are housewives. Some are blue collar and some are white collar. Some are from the United States. Some are from an international city. But they have different walks of life. In other words, different backgrounds, different lifestyles. When the Bible says walk in the Spirit, that's exactly what it's talking about. Have a lifestyle of spiritual living. Let the Holy Spirit be a lifestyle. Not just like, well, I'm in church, I'm going to walk in the Spirit while I'm in church, but man, when I get to work tomorrow, I'm going to live like the devil. No. Walk in the Spirit. Let your lifestyle, the habits of your life, be a Spirit-controlled life. And then may I point out something? The word walk is a verb there, and in the Greek text, it's very clear, it is an imperative command. It is a command of Scripture. How many of you would walk out and say, well, he didn't preach on murder today, so I'm going to kill somebody at work tomorrow? No. You wouldn't do that because why? Well, you know it's wrong. And how do you know it's wrong? Well, the Bible says, thou shalt not kill. So you just can't go into work tomorrow and take somebody out. It's just not part of the deal. And you didn't say, well, he didn't preach on adultery, so I'm going to get me a girlfriend tomorrow when my wife likes it or not. No, it doesn't work that way because the Bible says, thou shalt not commit adultery. You can't say, well, he didn't preach on stealing, so I'm going to knock off a bank tomorrow. I need a little extra cash. No, you won't do that. Why? Because you know that stealing is wrong because the Bible says, thou shalt not steal. In other words, ladies and gentlemen, there are commandments of Scripture. We call them the Ten Commandments. How many of you would walk out of here today and say, you know, I think I'll break 7 or 8 commandments tomorrow. Maybe not all of them, but maybe 6 or 8. No, you won't do it because you know those are commandments. Those are things that are literally set in stone. And here's what I want you to understand. The Bible doesn't have 10 commandments. The Bible has hundreds of commands. And this is one of them. And may I say, you say, well, is this as important as the 10 commandments? Listen to me. This is more important than the 10 commandments. Because until you obey this one, you'll no guarantee you'll obey any of them. But if you will obey this command, walk in the Spirit, you will have the ability to obey the other 10. So, brothers and sisters, I want you to see this morning that this is not a suggestion. It's a command. Walk in the Spirit. If you're not walking in a Spirit-filled life, you're out of the will of God. Billy Graham said, I don't hesitate in saying that anyone who's not Spirit-filled is a defective Christian. There are some things you can't negotiate. I'm sure you heard about that brand new naval battleship. It was out testing in friendly waters, and they had the admiral on board because it was the first time out. And the captain looked out into the foggy night distance, and he said, Admiral, the light on that vessel out there in the distance is on a collision course with us. The admiral said, send them a wire, send them a signal. Adjust your course. So the captain sent the signal, adjust your course. The message came back, adjust your course. The admiral didn't like that. The admiral said, you tell him, I am an admiral in the U.S. Navy. Adjust your course. The message came back, I'm a seaman first class. Adjust your course. Admiral was fuming. He said, send this message. We are a U.S. naval battleship. Adjust your course. The message came back, we are a lighthouse. Adjust your course. You see, ladies and gentlemen, some things you can't negotiate with. Some things are either right or they're wrong, they're true or they're false, and there is no way around it. And when it comes to the Spirit-filled life, listen, the Holy Spirit's a lighthouse. You got to do something, and you've got to walk in the Spirit. That's a command. But then I want you to notice you're in a conflict. You're in a conflict. Look at verse 17. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other. Somebody once said, give the devil an inch, he thinks he's a ruler. Brothers and sisters, you cannot give the devil an inch. Because what you give him as a foothold, he will take as a stranglehold. Because, brothers and sisters, I want you to listen to me. You are in a battle. You are in a war. And the body of Christ needs to wake up to this truth. Those are here in the room this morning, those watching by television, the internet, the app, whatever. Listen to what I'm saying to you. The body of Christ in the United States is watching the disintegration of our nation spiritually and morally, and we are still blaming those people out there. The problem is not people out there. Your battle is inside you. When you conquer that battle, you're going to be in a much better shape to witness and share to the people out there. And we are asleep in the light, and the world is asleep in the dark, and it's time for us to wake up. Our problem is not flesh and blood. Our problem is powers and principalities and something deep on the inside of us. And we've got to win this war before we're going to make any difference in this great nation of ours. Now, verse 17 says we're in a war. Look what it says. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit. And the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. That describes a war. And then notice what it says. The flesh and the Spirit are opposed to each other. It's like a movie where you see one army lines up on this side of the field and one army lines up on this side of the field and they are going to battle. And the Bible says that the flesh is opposed to the Spirit and the Spirit is opposed to the flesh. Sir, you're in a war. And the idea that you say, well, Pastor, you know, I don't sin that much. And, you know, I sin a little bit. Now, listen to this reasoning. I sin a little to keep me from sinning a lot. You know, kind of keeping it under control. Sir, that's like saying I'm going to throw gasoline on a fire to put it out. It doesn't work that way. You are in a war. Therefore, listen to me very carefully. There is no such thing as casual Christianity, especially in this generation we're living in. We need some people who are sold out. We need some people who are on fire. We need some ministers who are begging God for something that only God can do. We need some men and women to rise up in the pews and recognize it is God's time or we are doomed. It is time for the Lord's people to rise up in holiness, not in judgment of others, but in holiness in our own lives. That's the message we're not listening to. That's the message our flesh resists. It's so much easier to blame all those other people than it is to look right inside the person wearing your shoes and wonder, what's the problem? I went to the Billy Graham School of Evangelism in Ohio, and when I was there, we went to the Cincinnati Crusade back in 77, and I saw Dr. Graham for the first time. And the first time I ever saw Dr. Graham, he made this statement. I'll never forget it. The Christian life is not a playground. It's a battleground. And brothers and sisters, that is true. You're in a conflict. You've got to have the Holy Spirit to help you. But then I want you to see something else. Not only is there a command, not only is there a conflict, I want you to see it's continual. Look at verse 17. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit. You see, there's a verb. The desires of the flesh are against the Spirit. That's a verb. And the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other. That word opposed, it's a verb. To keep you from doing what you want to do. That word keep you, that phrase keep you from doing, that's a verb. And the things you want to do, that's a verb. There are four verbs in verse 17 in the Greek New Testament, and all of them are present tense verbs. You know what the significance of that is? That means that if you say, well, you know, Pastor, I got saved in the 70s, and I got filled with the Spirit. I got all that taken care of. Now I'm okay. Are you kidding yourself? Man, you're involved in a battle now. Your battle is not in the 1970s. Your battle is not in the 1980s. Your battle is not yesterday. Your battle is right now. While you're sitting here in this church house is your battle, and it's now, and your enemy will not rest. He is out to steal, to kill, and to destroy, and he never waits. He never sleeps. He's after you. He wants your jugular. He wants your life. He wants to destroy your testimony. He wants to destroy your family. He wants to destroy your conscience. He wants to destroy you from the inside out. He wants to give you depression and defeat and disillusionment. And he wants you to think somehow that you don't have to worry about it today. Maybe you'll worry about it later. Brothers and sisters, you got to worry about it. You got to deal with it right now. James McDonald said, and I quote, God has provided no other way for you to successfully live the Christian life apart from his Spirit filling you every moment of every day. The good news is he promises unlimited refills. Amen? So brothers and sisters, even if you failed on your way to church this morning, even if you're in a lifestyle right now of complete and total abdication of your Christian values, even if you are living a secret life in which God is not being glorified and honored in your private life, and God knows it and you know it, you can start over with God today. You can begin again in the Lord, because this battle is a continual battle, and you can step up and you can start again. You know, Jerry Falwell was a controversial figure while he lived. Everybody probably had an opinion about him one way or the other. But I got to know him in the later years of his life, and I want to tell you, he was a very nice person. One of the most easygoing, lovable people, not like the strong personality you would see on television. And the last time I saw him, we're in a very small room, no bigger than my conference room upstairs where we have our staff meetings. Just a small group of younger pastors. Jerry Falwell was there, very informal, very casual. And we were just sitting around talking about the Christian life. And Dr. Falwell said, guys, talking to us younger guys, he said, guys, the devil is a snake. And he will lay in the tall weeds of your life for 30 years waiting to strike if he has to. My brothers and sisters, don't ever say to yourself, well, Pastor, I'm kind of beyond the stage of having much temptation. Are you joking me? Child of God, do you think I am less of a target today than I was the day I got saved? Do you think that the enemy is less concerned about you now that you've made some progress in the spiritual life? You've grown a little bit in the Christian life. You're starting to influence children and grandchildren and co-workers, and you say, I'm too old to be tempted and the devil doesn't care about me anymore. You're a bigger target. The further you go with God and the longer you serve him, the more you're a target for the enemy and the more you need the armor of the Holy Spirit on your life. Listen, I like what Beth Moore said. Beth Moore said, the enemy shoots fiery darts, but he never shoots fiery darts at armor. He doesn't waste his fiery darts on armor. He only shoots his fiery darts at unguarded parts of our life. Don't ever think, my brothers and sisters, that you can lay the cross down and be at ease in Zion. It does not work that way. But then I want you to see one final thing. This is a matter of control. Control. What do I mean? Look at verse 18. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Billy Graham once said, if we as Christians try to make ourselves better or good, or even acceptable to God by some human effort, we will fail. Everything we have and are and do comes through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hey, brothers and sisters, did you notice the subtle difference between verse 16 and verse 18? In verse 16, he says, walk by the Spirit. That's a command. That's something you can do. In verse 18, he subtly shifted the voice of the verb. He said, be led by the Spirit. Verse 16, that's active. Walk, you do it. Verse 18, if you're led by the Spirit, that's passive. In other words, the passive voice of a verb means you're not doing the action. The action is taking place on you. Here's what that means, brothers and sisters. It means that in the Christian life, so much about the Christian life is I'm going to do this. I'm going to do better. I'm going to read my Bible. I'm going to pray. I'm going to go to church. I'm going to tithe. I'm going to fast. I'm going to witness. I'm going to serve. I'm going to minister. Amen. That's great. We need 10,000 people like that at Hyde Park and the Quarries Church. But listen to me, brothers and sisters. Ultimately, the joy of the Christian life is not what you do for God. It's what he's doing for you. The Bible says, walk in the Spirit, and as you do, you'll feel that you are led by the Spirit. That's the Spirit's work in you. Isn't it amazing, my brothers and sisters, that we can try and try and try, and finally it comes down to an issue of control. Listen to this. The only way to victory is surrender. But you don't surrender to the enemy. You're going to whip the enemy. You surrender to your king. You surrender your allegiance to your commanding officer. and your life becomes a life that is surrendered to the Holy Spirit's leadership. I mentioned Jim Symbol a minute ago. I was rereading the book Fresh Power this week. And there was a story in there about a young lady. I believe her name was Nicole Cruz. She was born in Germany. Her father was African-American. Her mother was German. Her father was killed while she was a young girl, and her mother became an alcoholic. And as a result, Nicole wanted nothing to do with drugs or alcohol because she saw it destroy her mother. But Nicole was a beautiful girl. She was tall. She was beautiful. She was in shape. And everybody said, you know what? You could be a model. So at 15, she went to the United States and she became a model. And she became a very successful model. She wasn't a Christian. She'd never been around Christians, but she didn't like drinking or drugs, any of that, because she saw that it would destroy lives. But she had a goal to be a Victoria's Secret model. Now, I know some of you are going to look at me like, what's that, Pastor? A Sherlock Holmes novel? Some mystery? Victoria's Secret? Hey, don't play with me. This is me you're talking to. I know you. She made up her mind she was going to be a Victoria's Secret model. And she had what it takes to become a top model in that industry. And so she started working at the age of 15, very successful model, going out on shoots, and she became a lingerie model. And one day another model invited her to church in Brooklyn. She went to Brooklyn Tab. She'd never been to church in her life, never owned a Bible, never heard about Jesus, went to church, liked the music, and was intrigued. Went back the next week and the next. On the fourth week, as the pastor was speaking, as Pastor Symbol was speaking, the Holy Spirit just got hold of her life and she gave her life to Jesus Christ. And she started going to Bible studies, having a prayer life, attending church regularly, and was enjoying her life more than she ever had, but she was still on this career path as a model. But the Lord was dealing with her. Nobody said to her, you can't be a model. Nobody said you're in the wrong business. And she was succeeding in life, but the Lord was dealing with her. And she gives her testimony in the book that she still loved to go out to the clubs and dance and go to parties and all of that, but she didn't drink or do drugs because she saw that as so destructive. But one night, she said, I went to my last party I ever went to. It was Halloween 2006. She said, I was so excited. I got all dressed up and went to the party, but the Lord was dealing with me. And in the first 10 minutes, for the first time in my life, I saw myself as I'd never seen myself before. She said, I looked and I saw the drugs at the party, the drugs, the alcohol, the homosexuality, the casual sex, and then she said, and a lot of weird stuff. And she said, something inside me said, I don't belong here. And she left and she didn't go back to that lifestyle. But she was still in that industry. And one day she said she was getting dressed to go out and, she looked at herself in the mirror, just going out to the mall or something with a girlfriend. She looked at herself in the mirror and she thought, my clothes look weird. So she went and changed her clothes. Then she came back, looked at herself again and said, what's wrong with me? And all of a sudden she realized that the Holy Spirit, even though nobody had said anything to her, but through Bible study, through prayer, through the Spirit leading her, she realized that she had not been dressing modestly as a beautiful woman. She saw herself perhaps as a person who could do differently and live differently and act differently and dress differently. So she said the hemlines went down, the necklines went up. The jeans and the t-shirts weren't quite so tight, but she was still in that business, a lingerie model. And then, slowly but surely, she said, the Holy Spirit just showed her that her industry was all about sex appeal. Sex, sex, sex. That was all it was about. And she realized that as a born-again, godly Christian woman, she could not any longer represent in that industry. And she prayed about it and went to the head of the agency, and she said, I just can't do these kind of shoots again. She said, I still want to be a model, but I don't want to be that kind of model. What happened to Nicole Cruz? Did somebody jump on her and tell her, you better not do that? No. She said, it's the farthest thing from it. But slowly but surely, the Holy Spirit just began to take control of her life and show her a different way. Brothers and sisters, when it comes right down to it, the Christian life is not about a bunch of us getting together and try to enforce a bunch of regulations on each other that none of us can even keep or that we will break privately when nobody's around to watch. The Christian life is about each of us individually taking our Bible in hand, reading it under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit and saying, Lord, how do you want to lead my life? Lord, how do you want me to live my life? And letting the truth of God's word and the power of the Holy Spirit conform us to his image, transform us, and make us more like Jesus. Brothers and sisters, God wants to do a mighty work in this room today. For some of us, it means breaking free from a habit that has held us captive for not days or weeks, but years or decades. And God can begin the process of setting you free today if you will begin the process of yielding your life to the Holy Spirit. Some need to come today and say, you know what, I've been resisting the Holy Spirit because I thought the Holy Spirit was another denomination. I didn't think it was for us. Listen, the Holy Spirit is for every Christian. And today you need to just say, I need to open my life up to the Holy Spirit for the first time. Others could say, you know what, I've never even become a follower of Jesus. And the very first thing you need to do is say, Lord God, forgive me of my sins. I believe you died on that cross for me, Lord Jesus. And I believe you rose from the dead for me. And oh, Jesus, I give up. I am not going to be able to do this on my own. I ask you to forgive me. Come into my life and save me today and cleanse me and give me a new hope and a new beginning. And today you could pray that prayer and God can transform your life. Listen, no matter how far down you've fallen, God can lift you up again and give you freedom today and a new resolve and a new day and a new beginning.